nobody could read a lyric any better than he. I think he and Ella Fitzgerald
right.
could read a lyric and tell you the essence of the heart.
Well,
he
really created, he lifted, I mean, Bing Crosby invented the art of intimate singing, the microphone, you know, but he lifted it to where you could tell.
I happen to like the megaphone myself.
Well, that, you and Rudy
Valley.
Valley
was yeah.
But, you know, that he just knew how to make
yes.
a psychological thing out of what he was singing. Like, you felt that was his life, just like Billie Holiday, the same kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
He was so honest about what he was singing that you felt this was part of his life. And we've all felt this, and just like he's feeling it. And it really communicates.
He was secure with those lyrics. They provided a scaffolding that elicited from him a kind of confidence. He was at ease in them. And what he did was, he made them his own. He painted, it was like a landscape in which he painted himself into, so that we can't even imagine half those songs now without his voice. You can't sing a lot of those songs. They're his. You just can't sing them. They belong to Sinatra.
There you are. That's an interesting photograph. You're almost looking up.
I never took my eyes off him. When
is that right?
Yeah, never. When Gordon Jenkins gave me a tip early on in my tenure with Frank Sinatra. Gordon took me under his wing. And he told me one of the most important things is never take your eyes off of him. The orchestra needs to see your hands. They don't need to see your face. You need to watch him. And I understood what he meant, because you could anticipate a phrase by watching the throat, watching when the lips started to move, watching the chest to see when the air was being taken in. And with Mr. Sinatra, the fun of it and the greatness of it was that he never sang the same song twice on consecutive nights. And he expected his conductor to anticipate where he was going, and you pretty much better do it.
1965, a piece may have been published in 66 in Esquire. You said, he is the champ who made the big comeback, the man who had everything, lost it, then got it back, letting nothing stand in his way, doing what few men could do. He uprooted his life, left his family, broke with everything that was familiar, learning in the process that one way to hold a woman is not to hold her. Just part of what you said. Tell me about Sinatra.
Well, I think
and
the quality, you're asking the quality that he seems to personify to all of us, and all of us will probably have a different vantage point on the subject. To me, it's endurance. I think Sinatra, with all the deference to the lyrics and the stage presence, but the endurance of the man, realizing that for the better part of a half a century, he's been on top. Granted, he's had his falls, and that reference testifies to that. But to be an entertainer in that most perilously of reckless professions, to be able to appeal to different generations of audiences in this fickle country where talent is absorbed and is disgorged so quickly, to be a figure for this from the World War II years to where we are at this time near the end of the century is remarkable.